Amos. We're going to have a quick study of it. Not quite sure we can do a... Because if we try to do an in-depth study, we probably would be here till next week. So let's turn our Bibles to the book of Amos. I'm not quite sure whether technology helps us to know the Bible or not, because it's so easy for you to just type A and M-O-S will just show up. You don't have to know exactly where it is on the Bible, on a paper Bible, and you look like you're a good Bible student. So anyway, it's well. Sometimes we should just bring a paper Bible, we should use a paper Bible, just so that we can, sharpen your sword, as it were. Sword drill, as Pastor Matthew was telling us on Sunday. All right, praise God. I want to read a verse from the book of Amos. It says that the word of Amos, one of the shepherds of Tekoa, what he saw concerning Israel 2 years before the earthquake when Uzziah was king of Judah and Jeroboam, son of Jehoash, was king of Israel. What he saw. And then he goes on to actually tell us, thank you so much, to tell us what he saw. So that kind of opens up the book of Amos. My question, the reason why I asked us to open that was really to ask a question along the lines of, how God uses men who are just ordinary shepherds or just ordinary workmen to actually deliver his word. Well, before we do that, let me do some housekeeping so that we're clear about what we ought to be doing or not do. Okay, a bit of housekeeping for us, please. If you want to use the toilets, you can do so by just going out through the corridor, turn right. In case of a fire, one of the ushers will tell you what to do. Please, if you're eating, and please do so quietly. If you want to ask questions, maybe I'm going to be a little bit more strict than Deacon Jennifer was last week. Please ask our questions succinctly and make contributions succinctly, because I know you guys have so much to say. If you have a mobile phone, kindly turn it to vibrate, or silence is probably better than vibrate, so that way you won't be distracting anyone. Thank you for braving the weather conditions that has changed on us and coming to this Tuesday Bible study. You will not leave the same way you have come in Jesus' name. There's something about the Word of God that just works like a drip. It just slowly, slowly and surely, you're getting more of it. You're becoming more acquainted to God. You're becoming more knowledgeable of God. And it happens over time. It doesn't happen by just mountaintop experience. It happens over time. That's why there's a difference between a blessing and a miracle. God blesses us. God doesn't want to be doing miracles in our lives every day, funny enough. Even though the general consensus of miracle or blessing is that most people flow towards a miracle. But actually, God wants to bless us. And blessing occurs continually. Just bit by bit, you're being blessed. A miracle means we have to forgo blessing now. We have to move everything to cause a change. Instead of a gradual change, we now need an immediate now change. That's a miracle. But when God called Abraham, he said, I will bless you and make your name great. He didn't say I will do miracles and I will bless you. That's why it took Abraham 25 years to have Isaac, because it was a blessing, not necessarily a miracle, although a blessing will have miracle in it, but it's more of a blessing than God. So the word of God comes to bless us as we partake of it gradually. All right, I'm going to follow this format, hopefully, by giving you an introduction, then go on to look at some titles. Then we'll do an overview, and I want to talk about captivity, why God uses captivity. We're going to explore some popular scriptures, then we go into the lessons. Hopefully, we can do one or two before the time we have allotted goes. All right. The book of Amos. You know, I've got up here that Amos, the name Amos means burden bearer. And we can ask ourselves who wrote the book of Amos. Who do you think wrote the book of Amos? So if you put your hand up, then someone will bring the mic to you. So you don't need to shout. Or there's a mic next to you, but don't worry about that. Just take the mic around, please. The book of Amos, yes. Who wrote it?
I would say Amos, because it says chapter 1, said the word of Amos.
So the word, okay.
Amos.
So who wrote the book of Matthew? Actually, better still, who wrote the book of Revelation, chapters 2 and 3? John, right? Or it's the words of Jesus.
Yeah, it was the word of Jesus. But John got the revelation.
Just because somebody spoke the words doesn't necessarily mean they wrote it. I'm not saying you are wrong, but, you know, I'm just trying to prove a point. Yeah, most of us will agree that Amos probably wrote his own book, putting it down on paper for the people of the time. So when was the book written? When do you think the book of Amos was written? Unlike Pastor Flores, I'm not looking for a year. I'm looking for the situation surrounding when the book of Amos was written. Go ahead, Godwin.
He said, according to the word here, they said it's 2 years before the earthquake that happens in Israel.
Yeah, 2 years before the earthquake. And it gives you the reigning kings of the time. Was Uzziah a good king or a bad king? And Uzziah, Judah. I was going to ask you where Uzziah, but was Uzziah a good king or a bad king? Was Uzziah a good king or a bad king? Yeah. But Edwin wants to help us. And if he doesn't, his wife has it in her notes. So
he was good initially, but later on he decided to usurp God's power.
By doing what?
Going to the to offer sacrifices in the temple.
And then what happened to him?
Yeah, he has got leprosy.
Leprosy broke out where? On his hand?
On his forehead.
That's forehead. Yeah. Okay, praise God. All right. You better draw your sword properly. Yeah, leprosy broke out on his forehead, and then the priest, he himself, the Bible says he himself wanted to get out quickly, and the priests got him out. So, Uzziah was a good king up to a point. Towards the end of his life was when he, he got too pompous because of all the conquests and the lot of territory he had gained, caused him to to heir with God by going to offer sacrifice, which was only allotted for priests to do. In fact, where he was going was only the high priest that was supposed to be in there. All right, what about Jeroboam? Was Jeroboam a good king? By the way, who was the father of Jeroboam? Who was the father of Jehoash? That Joash and Jehoash is the same. And which Jehu is this? Which Jeroboam is this? Is it the Jeroboam that reigned during the time of Rehoboam? Speak for yourself.
No, I don't think it was that. It was not that one. The one that reigned during the time of Rehoboam was Jeroboam, son of Nebat.
Uh-huh. Okay. And this one, I think if you check this well, it should go back to, this could probably be the fourth generation of Jehu. Because God also told Jehu that he would also have kings up to the fourth generation. I think it's Jehu. Anyway, so if you look at it, in the northern part of Israel, they were ruled by Jeroboam. In the southern part of Israel, they were ruled by Uzziah. And there was lots of prosperity within the kingdom at the time that the book was written. All right. Why was the book of Amos written? What's the purpose of the book of Amos? So when you answer that question, I want the question in two halves. The purpose for the book of Amos, for those who probably were living in that time, and I want to know for us. Yes. Because he had a vision. He had a vision. That's why he wrote the book. Okay. He wrote the book to put down, to document his vision. Okay. All right. Okay. Yes. And then Brother Godwin.
He wrote the book as a warning to the children of Israel and the Judah also.
As a warning to the nation of Judah and the nation of Israel. Okay, yes, that's very true. What else? What other reasons are there for the book of Amos to be written?
And the consequences of their
action.
Actions.
Yeah. The consequence of their actions. Okay. Anyone else has any addition to that as to why the book was written? Yeah? Do you want to say something? Okay. So, the answers you've given me was why the book was written for the people who lived at that time. So can you help me by letting me know why the book is written for us too? What can we get from the book of Amos ourselves? This is before we go into lessons. I want to know what you know. Yes.
As to kind of gain understanding and learn lessons, not to repeat the same thing that perhaps they may have done. It's kind of showing you what happened and for us to learn lessons and not to repeat the same thing as believe.
So that we won't fall into the same mistakes, fall into the same errors as they did. Okay, thank you. What else do we get from that?
It tells of God's justice. God is a righteous God and he will never entertain sin. His judgment is same thing everywhere, and anytime when it comes to sin, there's always judgment. But in line with the judgment, there's also the part of God's mercy about restoration if you do turn back to Him as well.
Yeah, there's a part of what's interesting is no matter how bad sin gets, there will always be a remnant, and it's that remnant that He restores and builds on. He has to build on something, and He won't build on sin. He will build on righteousness. So there will always be a few people who are the remnants that God will use to build on. Okay, so mercy, justice, and judgment, and of course, restoration too. All right. So we learn that about God. We learn that there's always a consequence for sin. There is a cause and effect. Okay, how do we reconcile this knowing that we are forgiven? Are you saying the question again? Yeah. We agree that when we read the book of Amos, they sinned, God punished them. All right? Okay? Well, there's no debate about that. God listed their sins, and we're going to read some of it. But how do we reconcile this with a new covenant, which we know we are already forgiven for past, present, and future sin?
I think you, believer, always is based on faith. We ask for forgiveness from mm-hmm. God. It's just for us to believe that it's been forgiven.
Okay, so we won't get any punishment.
Yeah, we won't get any punishment if we believe that it's our sins been forgiven.
Okay, all right. Okay. Anyone else?
Mm-hmm. Praise God. At the Old Testament saints, when they sin, and they repent, their sins were forgiven, but were not covered because Christ had not died. But in this new Testament dispensation, Christ had died, mm-hmm. He had shed His blood. So when we sin mm-hmm. and we repent genuinely, mm-hmm. The blood, that precious blood of Christ mm-hmm. takes away our sins completely. At the Old Testament period, they didn't have that opportunity.
Their sin was covered under the old covenant.
Yeah, but was not taken away.
Mm-hmm. So what does that mean in practice?
In practice, it means that the dispensation of the audit from the New Testament believer mm-hmm. has lived under the period of grace. And that grace was brought about from the death and resurrection of Christ. However, there is a consequence for the sins committed. So there's a price to be paid, because it's when you commit sin, you plant a seed, and you definitely reap what you sow. On following the law of sowing and reaping.
Okay, all right. So we've had two different views. One says if you sin, you're forgiven. You don't pay. You repent. You believe that. That's it. Done. Another one says there's a consequence. So who else has another opinion? Or where do you sit on those two camps? How many of us sit on the forgiven, no consequence? One. How many of us sit on forgiven, but there's consequence? How many of us are on the no no consequence, no? All right. The Bible tells us that the wages of sin is death, right? That death is what I believe is taken away. I do not believe that if we sin, there are no consequences. I don't believe that. I believe that, for example, okay, let's take an example. You go and steal in your job. You take a lot of money. And you are caught and you really repent. And God forgives you, really. But you could still lose that job as a consequence of your actions. But because you repent, God can give you another job that is even better than that one. But there is always cause and effect. Otherwise, this life just won't be fair. So even though the outright, the end result of sin is death, so in that case, you know, what the enemy will want is that you never get a job. Understand? The consequence coming, I wouldn't say the consequence is coming from God, but it's coming from laid down principles that operates on the earth. So I'm not comfortable with the way we ascribe certain things to God. Because we need to understand that God has laid down certain principles that are operational on the earth. He doesn't need to do anything for that to work. If you sow, you reap. Period. It doesn't have to come and start manipulating that. God doesn't do that kind of stuff, all right? Now, can God bring about an abundance because? Yes. But however, those principles are laid down. Otherwise, if God violates that principle, let's say, okay, this is one good argument I've heard, which would be quite good to illustrate the point. Somebody says, well, I believe God, I have faith that if I stand on that building and I jump down, you know, I believe God that, you know, nothing will happen to me, right? You have faith, okay? For that to happen, for God to be part of that kind of faith, he has to suspend gravity. If God suspends gravity because of that one person, what's going to happen to all the rest of the people who believed God whilst they're walking down the road? They're not going to be flying everywhere. And cars will be flying everywhere because the law of gravity has been suddenly suspended because this man of God is up there and wants to jump down. So in the same way, there is consequence. Although, through forgiveness, we don't experience the full measure of that consequence. So for example, you know what's interesting? This occurred to me the other day. Do you know that none of David's men ever spoke to him about the sin with Bathsheba? That was recorded anyway. But if it's not recorded, and really, God is pointing something out to us. That when God forgave him, right, God also dealt with the heart of the people around him. Really, what he did, any one of them could have thought, oh my God, this man of God, he can do that to my own wife too. No, let's rise up and kill him. God may have forgiven him, but no. None of them said anything about it to him anymore. You guys are trying to tell me they don't remember it? Of course they remembered. But I don't know of a scripture where somebody actually confronted him that, David, you know, you did this. The writers remind us. So in that sense, the wages of David's sin was death. But then under the old covenant, someone might say, well, but the child died. But David was the one who sinned. So I would suggest, but he had the consequence, even though he was forgiven. He had planted a bad seed. And Amnon ended up raping the sister, and Absalom ended up, waging a coup on him, and he had to run away, and he suffered for that, and, So I think the price we pay may not be as heavy, but, there's a consequence. Otherwise, we might as well go around and sin and say, there's nothing. The Bible says that, can we go on sinning so that grace would just abound? Well, it also tells us that where there is sin, grace abounds all the more. Meaning that in a situation whereby it is easy to sin, there is the grace that comes. The Bible tells us in the book of Titus, it says that the grace of God has appeared to us and teaches us to say no to ungodliness. So there is that. There is those scriptures. We can't take one scripture. All right. Okay, quick.
So understanding your explanation, what we get from there is that the grace that abounds to us is the grace that prevents us from falling into sin.
Oh, yeah. Definitely. Okay,
I just want to make that clarification.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You will notice that before you sin, there is this huge amount of grace that comes alongside you, plus you've got the Holy Spirit that comes alongside you and tries to prevent you from sinning. There's none of us who is born again that sins, that has not experienced that sudden grace and power that helps you. But you may choose not to give yourself to it. Understand? Yeah? Okay. All right. That's really good for us to explain like that. Okay. The other thing is, if you are going to title the book of Amos, what would you call it?
Prophetic book.
Prophetic book?
Yes.
What about the book of Ezekiel? Non-prophetic.
Ezekiel is prophetic also.
Prophetic too. So you title that prophetic book. Well, what would you title Obadiah? Prophetic book. Okay, that was just a general title. Okay, it's a prophetic book. Thank you.
I mean, that's for Amos.
Amos, a book of warning. All right, what about Jeremiah? What about Micah? Is that a book of friendliness? Maybe Isaiah is a friendly one.
I stick to this one for now.
Okay, praise God. Times when, can a believer be captive? Yeah.
Say yes.
Give me a scripture then.
Okay, well, this fit in. Where, I think Matthew, where God says, anything you love more than me becomes like your God. Then you are like slave to that thing. Or anything you hold on to, which is not godly, above God.
Mm-hmm. All of you thinking about it from Romans chapter 6, isn't it? Romans 6:16. Don't you know that when you offer yourself to someone to obey him as slaves, you are slaves to the one whom you obey? Okay, yes. Yeah. There can be times when God has delivered you and you can go back into captivity. Somebody is delivered from sin and still goes back sinning, they're going to be held captive by that sin. Actually, that's one of the reasons why God is saying to us, you know, stay away from sin. Because it's gonna hold someone captive. Yes, Pastor Forrest.
I was just going to compare this to the scripture in Galatians 5, verse 7, where Paul was addressing them, say, we are running a good race.
Yeah, we're quoting on you.
Yeah, when they wanted to go back to the circumcision thing, you know, most of the time we are saved, talking about still talking about tradition, as even Romans confirmed that we need to renew our minds. Like, yeah. God has delivered us from a lot of things, and yet still we go back to it, go back to tradition. We want to hold on to some of these things as if we don't do it, we'll die or we'll go to hell.
Yeah.
You know? So, we can if we don't guard ourselves.
That's right.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Yes?
And there are sometimes, as a believer, if you started experiencing blessings of God,
mm-hmm.
and then you start misusing it like riches, or God is blessing you for a reason, to be a blessing to his kingdom, and then you started using it in a bad way, mm-hmm. I think God can bring you back to where you were for you to learn some lessons, because you are not using it for the reason why he's blessing you.
Okay.
Because I've seen some experiences from some people.
From people.
Yeah,
okay.
And then they learn from it and then go back doing the right thing.
Okay. Yes.
Another example can be taken from Acts 5, the story of Ananias and Sapphira. Because of their sin, they died. That may not necessarily mean that they did not meet heaven, but they died. They had to die for the sin of lying. So they were given over to that judgment because of their sin.
So who pronounced judgment on them? Is it God?
No, it's not God. That was
who is
Paul.
It then?
Peter.
Okay.
Because Peter said they made Holy Spirit a liar.
Okay. Okay. Oh, they make Holy Spirit a liar of it?
No, the comment about Ananias and Sapphira. When they died, they went straight to hell because they had no time to repent. Because the judgment was passed right there and then. Yeah.
Oh, my God.
That was a straight judgment. Sorry.
I wish you wouldn't say that now.
Oh. I agree to that as well.
No. I definitely completely disagree with that. Let me tell you why.
Hey, sir.
First of all, the Bible doesn't teach us that. What the Bible teaches us, actually, the closest scripture we have to whether somebody is sinning goes to heaven or hell is in 1 Corinthians 5.
Should we go there, sir?
1 Corinthians 5, which tells us that because this guy is sleeping with the wife of the dad, therefore that person, I'm completely distracted now. Please, one of the ushers next time, please help to do that. So, Where was I?
First Corinthians
5. Which tells us that really, the guy was sleeping with his dad's wife. It says, commit him to the hands of Satan so that his flesh may be dealt with and that, and his soul may be saved. Please read it, sir. That's the closest scripture we have to that situation about if, and I will tell you something else again. I will say something else. Let's read just that verse first.
To deliver such an one unto Satan for the destruction of the flesh,
yeah,
that the spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus.
Yeah. It says, deliver him to the hands of the devil so that he can still be saved. That person may have no chance of repentance. Now, hang on. Let me tell you what I'm not saying. I am not saying that, therefore, you should go and sin. Because if you die now, even if you are sinning, you're going to go to heaven. No. You're going to understand that what the scripture is teaching us is anybody who practices sin will not make heaven. Because that's the lifestyle of the person. It was not the lifestyle of Ananias and Sapphira to be lying. They lied on that occasion, and Peter wanted to punish them because he didn't want other people to see their practice and follow it. So therefore, he commanded that they must die. So they died. So somebody said, well, they're not going to make heaven. Now, I disagree. But I disagree. Unless you find me a scripture that supports your point. Okay. Good. Let's go.
You said Peter pronounced this is telling him to die, but he only said this in the book of Acts 5, verse 9.
Mm-hmm.
It says, look for verse 5, it says, and Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in verse 4, Peter said, why it remained, was it not thine own? Sorry, it says, verse 3 says, Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost?
That's correct.
And to keep back part of the peace of the land.
Yes.
It says, and why it remained, was it not thine own? And after it was sold, was it not in thy own power? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God.
That's correct.
Right, the judgment was not passed by Peter. Peter only condemned what he did. Mm-hmm. But it was God who now judged him.
Okay, who, thank you that you said that. One other point before we leave that scripture, and I'll take it to another one, was the fact that when Ananias came in, what did he say? When Sapphira came in.
Sapphira verse says that, and 8 says, and Peter answered unto her, tell me whether you sold the land for so much.
Mm-hmm. Go
and
to the said, other bit,
Yeah, for so much. Then Peter said unto her, how is it that ye have
the feet of those
together to tempt the Israel, Lord? Behold, the feet of them which have buried thy husband at door, and shall carry thee out.
The feet of those who buried your husband are still at the door, and they will carry you out. What's that?
Yeah, they'll do the same thing. What happened to your husband?
What same thing?
A death.
Death.
Yeah.
So you pronounce death, at least we can agree, pronounce death on Sapphira, right?
Or you're going to say no? Ananias. Ananias was like a judgment from God. So basically, whatever happened to it's.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. I concede on Ananias. I don't concede on Sapphira. Peter pronounced death on Sapphira. For sure. Absolutely. And I still think he commanded on Ananias, but because of what you've read, I cannot argue the point. So I'll leave it. But I would say, though, that in the scripture you read first, in 1 Corinthians 6, It's the church that determined to actually give somebody over to Satan. Actually, we don't exercise that. I've never heard it exercised in church. Well, or it's very rare. Yeah, and I really think we should use it more. But honestly, I do. Particularly for those who feel that they can be sinning and then, you can't tell me what to do kind of thing. And they're holding positions and they're affecting other people and the thing is spreading because of them. I think we should. But that's another debate. But here's the point that if Paul said the church, you guys, when you get together, commit this person to the hands of Satan, that Satan to do what? Take him out to lunch? No. To kill him, basically. To kill his flesh so that his soul may be saved. So in the same way, Peter, being representing the church, had the authority and the right, standing where he was on that point, Ananias and Sapphira, to pronounce death on them. He had the right. He had the authority to do so. That's why I conclude that he did. But, yeah?
Yeah. It's a good point by Edwin.
It is a good point.
Raised. I was just thinking of the scripture in Mark that says he has given us all power and authority and also the power to allow and to disallow.
Matthew 16, whatever we bind on earth, we bound in heaven, or whatever believes.
Yeah, also we know that we are going to be judging and in Revelation, so God has still given us that power to do that here as well, on at which Peter, like Paul, will say, me too, I have the spirit, I have the spirit of God.
Yeah.
So, like you said, we are not using that much. It's not happening in church because we are scared that, what if we say... And somebody does, and somebody bought. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yes, sir. No, just a comment about the, when it says you should give that brother over to Satan.
Sure.
Is it not the same case as where God gave Judah and the people of Israel
over
to captivity?
It's correct.
So in that way, when his person is buffeted, then he can see the effect of what he has done, or the suffering he undergoes. Then he can now say, "Wow, I was actually in a good place with God, and now return back to God."
Absolutely. Actually, saying that, I believe that was the final judgment that should come upon that guy. That's not the first judgment that should come upon him. The best judgment that should have come upon him was what Paul then went on to talk about. He said, if somebody calls us a believer and is living like this, don't go out with them. Don't eat with... You know, if we did that, most people would stop sinning in church. We won't have to get to, now we're going to commit it to the hand of Satan. But if we said, bro, the way you are living and the way God said we should live is different, so please... Until you change, don't call me. And I'm not going to buy chicken and chips with you. If you want to go buy chicken and chips, you go on it by yourself. I'll be behind you. Honestly, I know it sounds funny, but the person will be like, okay, I will stop. But what happens generally is, what you're doing is none of my business, as long as I'm not doing it, blah, blah. That's a nonsense. That's not scripture. And then the person goes to another church, which is,
Just to say that the Jehovah Witnesses practices that.
Oh, really?
They do expel, and the church is warned that no one should associate with that person.
Okay, even though we're not subscribing to Jehovah Witness thing, so let's not take any question on that, please, or comments, because I'm not going to speak about them, unless you want to say something else.
Because without Jehovah Witnesses, they expel for basically everything. If you read the Bible. Ask questions on the Bible.
Yeah. Okay. Let's not talk about that. Okay. Quickly.
Just to say, in the case of Ananias and Sapphira, it's interesting that what would have happened if perhaps they didn't die. What would have happened in terms of the growth of the church and so on after that? So it was quite strategic in a way.
Absolutely.
And also, we have to also remember that in the confronting sin, the stages that we have to go through, because, you know, as you said, and as Jesus clearly lays out in Matthew 18, there's a process before you get to the final way. It doesn't have to get to that.
No.
So I think we have to be doing that a lot more as church. We have to take responsibility. And we thank God that God makes it that it's church that decides, because he's put us all in a position where we are supposed to call to account. And we're open with one another, that we can deal with one another in that way.
Yeah. It's not God's will for anyone to end up the way Paul was suggesting for that guy to end up. God's will is one-to-one. You go to the person and you try and, you know, deal with it. You talk to them, and you, at that point, that you hope that if it's going to be quick, you hope.
Okay,
that
so what can we say? Because this happened in churches whereby brothers and sisters, there will be grievances or something, and instead of the other person to come up and say it openly, that my brother, you heard me in this way, or my sister, you offended me this way, they will just decide to leave the church or to just cordon themselves off that person. How do we now deal with that?
We can't. That's the point. We have to let people know what the Word of God says, and they have to choose to do it or not do it. You can't force anybody to do anything. God doesn't force people. It's bad, and I wish it doesn't happen that way, but it does. People feel, no, I don't want to tell that person. And they say, I don't want to tell them, so I'm just going to walk away. And people do that. There's nothing anybody can do about it. Even God cannot do anything about it.
I was just going to add concerning that there are different cases to situations that is. For example, if it's in a leadership kind of situation where you're attending church, mm-hmm. but perhaps maybe there is maybe a deacon,
mm-hmm.
that you, a church member, feel offended by. Yeah. Perhaps maybe they did something that you didn't, yeah. you didn't like.
Uh-huh.
And but because of their position, you don't know how to kind of confront them and deal with it, and you don't know how to reach maybe to a higher minister and communicate, or put forward your grievance in a written form to say, okay, this is what I felt, this is what happened. I couldn't perhaps maybe confront either the deacon or whoever, or maybe a higher usher in that kind of position. So I didn't know how to do it. So because of that, all the situation that happened, it overwhelmed me. So I ended up leaving the church.
Okay.
So there are different kind of cases that happen. It could happen between a church member or leader or a deacon or okay. an usher or something.
I understand. But that's not what God wants. Okay? This is what God wants. So we have to go back to, okay, what does God say? God didn't say, you know, let me say something. I've said this before, for Peter to be able to tell Jesus, you're not going to the cross, means that Peter had access to Christ in such a way that we should have access to people who are above us in that same way. Meaning, anybody can tell you that, you know what you said, I'm really not happy about it. But sometimes, I'm going to say something, and I don't want anybody to be offended. But here's the reality. If we ourselves as believers do not know who we are, when we look at a pastor, we place them in a role that God has not put them. Because we ourselves don't know who we are. There are times when a pastor or a leader in the church elevates themselves so high up that you cannot go to them. I agree. But that's not what God wants. God wants us to be able to talk to anybody, to say, and there's a way you can talk to a leader, whether they like it or not, you can still say, well, I'm still not happy with what you did. And if they say, oh, how dare you talk to me, then you're quiet. But you've told them, at least you're not happy. I think we should always say it. Even if the person is not going to, you can't decide how the person will react, but you can decide to follow the Word of God. That's what we can do. okay, to say I'm not happy with what happened. Yes.
Just like King David when he sinned, and prophet, what's his name again?
Nathan.
Because remember, at the time of King David, he had the authority to send
killed.
Killed. But God gave him the wisdom to speak.
Yeah.
So in any situation, we should always ask the Holy Spirit for how to speak.
Yeah.
And he will direct us.
Yeah. Amen. Okay. Good. Thank you. We're going to go on. For some reason, that just took quite a bit of time. All right. I want us to look at some popular scriptures from the book of Amos. In chapter 4, verse 12, it says, prepare to meet your God. Chapter 5, verse 6, seek God and live. Then chapter 3, verse 3, can two walk together except they agree? What is he talking about there? Amos 3:3.
It's about God and you. Okay, God is a righteous God. For you to walk with him, you have to be righteous. There's no way you can go with God if you're on the opposite way.
Okay, so sometimes we may have used that scripture to talk about unity, but really in the context of which it's written, it's about the fact that those people, Israel, were not aligned with God. And so they're not going to walk together. You're not going to do Baal a bit and then come and do me a bit. It's not going to happen like that, because then we're not together. Okay.
Some people also use that verse for in context of marriage.
Yes. Yes. You know, I probably used it. I haven't used it in marriage, but I probably used it in the wrong context. But really, if we look at the context in which it's written, It is not about unity. It's actually about disunity. It's about disagreement and not agreement. So, this final one. Shall there be evil in a city and the Lord has not done it? It's in your Bible, right?
Read it in a way where we just pick out the verse and not realize that there is a whole context to it.
Okay, what's this verse saying to you?
Okay, where is it?
Amos 3, verse 6. That's the second part. That's the B part of it. Is it verse 6?
I can't even find Amos anymore.
Okay, read the KJV. I think it's KJV.
Yes, sorry, if someone can find it. I can't find it. Oh yeah, there you go.
Almost there. Amos 3 what?
3:6. Does it say that?
3:6. So you say
yeah. Be part of
when
six.
When a trumpet sounds in a city,
yeah.
Do not the people tremble.
Yeah.
When disaster come to a city, has not the Lord caused it?
Yeah.
Surely the sovereign Lord does nothing without revealing his plan to his servant, the prophets.
Have you ever heard this scripture, this particular scripture used, that, you know, when there's evil in a city, has the Lord not done it? You've not heard it? I've heard it. Yeah? Go ahead.
I might be wrong, but to me it sounds like, from the writer's point of view, it's like he's trying to communicate a message to the readers that, look, when something happened, is it not from the Lord? Or when God is about to create something in a city, or about to give a word, does he not reveal it to his prophet? So to me, it doesn't sound like God is saying that God will bring about evil in the city, but he's saying that he's using it in a context of where
God brought the disaster, the evil, whatever you want to say it. God brought it on that city because of the sin recorded in chapter 6, verses 1-8 or 9, okay, on that particular scripture. So when it says that, does a lion roar without there being a prey? Can two work together unless they agree? Does a trumpet sound without this? It's just basically telling us the same things over and over again, that God is about to do something, and he's going to do something on this city because of their practice. So I agree with the fact that this particular verse is about God bringing judgment, an impending judgment or a judgment on a city because of what they've done. Now, we cannot take this scripture and go use it on 9/11, as I've heard people say. They say, oh, whenever something bad happens, God is bringing judgment. There is no country on earth right now that there's no sin. Absolutely none. I don't know of any, unless there's no human beings there. As long as there's human beings there, there is sin on that land. So we cannot take this scripture and go start applying it everywhere, because it cannot work that way. Okay? The context of this scripture is where it is. We have to leave it there. And we have to understand the covenants. You must always think about, when you hear scripture like this, always go back and think about covenants. Under the old covenant, they agreed verbally, categorically, that whenever they sinned, God should bring disaster on them. They said it, they agreed it, they signed up for it. Under the new covenant, we didn't sign anything. The covenant is between God and God the Father and Jesus, and we by faith enter into that covenant. Now, I am not saying that evil cannot come upon a city because of man's action. Right now, where we are right now, God, okay, let me put it like this. Where we are right now, God has said, bless you, there's coming a time when he is going to bring disaster on the world. He has said that. So we will know when this is now God doing it, because he's told us he's going to do it, right? But I think at the moment, we are experiencing a lot of sowing and reaping, cause and effect, because man also has dominion on the earth and can choose to do and undo according to how they feel and what side of the bed they get up. So really, you know, a lot of disasters we experience, even down to perhaps some of the earthquakes and some of the, is caused by the way that we've affected the atmosphere, by our pollution and all kinds of stuff that we do. God doesn't even have to do anything, because God is still going to do something. We're told in Hebrews chapter 1 that the earth is going to be rolled away. So he's going to do that rolling. There is no, you know, amount of, you know, some people say that our children are being taught now about what will happen, you know, about the ozone layer and the causes of disaster, impending disaster because of the way we are living. Then the earth is going to, okay, really? I'm not saying that we shouldn't look after the atmosphere. And I'm not saying that we should keep polluting the atmosphere. But really, the end is not going to come that way. That's not how it's going to come. Some people think that's how it's going to come, so they're trying to protect everything. That's not how it's going to work. The way it's going to work is Jesus will come back and he will decide the time and the hour. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Who would have known the book of Amos? There's no lessons today. Well, we've had our lessons. So I printed out some of the lessons there, so we can take some of this, and then we will also send it into the WhatsApp. Thank you. We'll put it in the WhatsApp group so that we can access it. Amen. Amen. Praise God. So, yeah. I didn't know that I'd over-prepared, but... Okay, praise God. I just knew that the Lord will have me talk about the captivity thing, and I just didn't know how or where that's going to lead us. But that just led us. So there's some lessons there. If the notes, please, I think I should have put a PS there, or please note that if it has errors, it's because it's not been checked. Okay, let's give unto the Lord as we are.